Hola chicos, ¿cómo están? Bienvenidos. El día de hoy tenemos una entrevista increíble con una personalidad del patinaje sobre hielo. Gracias a todos por estar aquí. Les recuerdo a quienes no se hayan suscrito, por favor, suscríbanse a mi canal. Y si alguno de ustedes quiere que lea alguna pregunta o comentario al final de la entrevista, no dejen de utilizar el super chat, por favor. Hi everybody, I hope you're doing great. Thank you for tuning in today to Cafecito con Masha. I'm thrilled because today we have a top coach and personality of figure skating in the whole world. I'm super excited. Please subscribe to my channel if you haven't yet. And if you want me to read a comment or a question to our guest at the end of the interview, please use the super chat. So I want to introduce our guest today. He's an Olympic figure skating coach, 10 times world coach. He's coach of 20 national champions, and he has a degree in exercise science. So let's welcome Tom Sakrajek. Hi, Tom, how are you? Oh, your microphone. Hold on. Okay, now you're in.
Hola, Masha, and all my friends in Mexico. So nice to be here on your show tonight.
Thank you. I'm so excited. Everybody has been asking about this interview because it's not the same to interview skaters than interviewing coaches. It's like a different approach of things. So it's very interesting. And so many coaches from Mexico want to hear your stories and your advices and everything.
Oh, wow. Well, I'm so honored. I've been to Mexico several times for vacation, to Cozumel and Puerto Vallarta.
Nice.
And of course, I've been to the Junior Grand Prix there several times, maybe every time that it's been held there. So, and for a couple years, I coached Florencia Calderon. So was, you know, and I hablo español un poquito, estudio en la escuela para tres años. So I know a little bit.
Bien, Tom. That's amazing. Not so many people from the United States speak Spanish, and you have a good accent, so that's perfect.
Okay, thank you. Gracias.
Yay. Okay, so let's start. I have a big question. You know how every skater has a different personality, different styles, different bodies. So you can't coach everybody in the same way. You have kind of to adapt your coaching or your technique to different people. So how do you adapt your coaching to those differences?
I mean, I think that's a great question. And for all the coaches who are listening in particular, it's probably something that gets overlooked. Right. I think you can look around the world and you can say, well, there are many coaches that just teach this technique and all their skaters look the same. And maybe all the body types look the same. In the United States, I've been fortunate to work with so many different male and female skaters that have totally different bodies. Right. Yeah. And so from a very early time in my career, I realized how important my studies at the university were going to be. Because once you have a foundation of biomechanics and you understand movement, then all you have to do is watch the movement in front of you.
Yeah.
And it doesn't matter what the body type is, but you have to notice things like the size of the skater's head in relation to their feet, how their shoulders and hips may line up. What is the length of their arms to their legs and in relation to the torso?
Absolutely.
So as soon as you start to be an observer and then you understand how quick they are or maybe not so quick they are, It becomes your job as a coach to really make those adjustments and suggestions to them in order for them to accomplish the task. And that could be a jump, but it also could be, you know, basic skating skills. It could be like a spin position. Doesn't matter what you're teaching them on the ice, but there's going to be some biomechanical principle involved. So that's on body type. The other part of your question was on personality.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that's a great question. And certainly the coach brings a certain personality to their coaching, right? I mean, I am who I am and you are who you are. And I think being able to adapt at certain points in the career is important. And I've been very fortunate to coach many skaters for many, many years, like Ryan Bradley and Jeremy Abbott and Rachel Flatt. Those three in particular, I coached from the time they were very young, like 9, 10, 11 years old. I mean, I started coaching Ryan Bradley when he was 5. Oh, and I coached them all the way through their national titles and their world championship appearances. And with Rachel, I coached her to the Olympic Games. Mm-hmm. So when you work with an athlete when they're very young, it's a totally different relationship than when you work with them as they become teenagers and young adults. So you can watch, I mean, their personality is their personality, but you can also watch them change and grow and evolve. And I think a really good coach is sensitive to that, right?
Yeah.
You have to be able to understand that they are kind of, what I would say, they're growing in every way, not just as an athlete, but they're growing emotionally and physically and mentally. There's so much development that goes on. And so, you know, that's very different than coaching someone like Max Aaron or Mirai Nagasu or Vincent Joe, for example. Those three athletes I got later in their career, and they had already learned figure skating from other coaches. They had already had a system of doing things. So there's always a kind of like a getting to know period when you take on a new athlete that's been coached by someone else and that's a different age group. Yeah. So, you know, that's just a totally different coaching experience than when you groom talent from young ages to the higher level. And I think most coaches in our sport work with developing talent, right?
Yeah, of course.
The pool of talent at the top is a small percentage. And now, for example, I'm starting to coach Brady Tennell for a couple months. So we're getting to know each other. We're getting to know our language of skating. And I think when she first came to work with me, she was testing me out. She was seeing if she liked how I coached, right? I mean, that's kind of normal, right? To be able to do something like that. So, and then, you know, you find out if it's gonna work or not, right? And sometimes no matter how much knowledge you have, you might not be the right match for an elite athlete, right? And that happens.
And usually how long does it take for you when you have a new skater who was with another coach? Does it depend on the person or usually, I don't know, maybe it takes a year, some months for you? How it's usually?
Okay, so I'll use Paige Rydberg as an example. This is our third season together. And even though we clicked right away, it's taken a couple years. Sometimes it can take 1 or 2 years. Look at the relationship that Raphael has developed with Mariah Bell.
Yeah.
No, there was some success initially. But then, you know, there was a period where it was rough and, you know, now she's going again. I think that's kind of typical, right? So I do think depending on the skater and how well you match, it can take shorter or longer, right? I think right now, if I use Brady as an example, we've been able to gel really well, really quickly. Don't ask me why, right? It's hard to explain. Sometimes that relationship you have with the student goes beyond anything you can describe or put your finger on, right?
Yeah. It's like human relationships are like that. So you never know how it's going to work.
Yeah.
So you have a degree in exercise science. So I'm really interested to know how you adapt that knowledge into developing champions?
Sure. I mean, I think that's a good question. So I have a couple of young skaters right now that are brilliant. They're on the national development team. There's one of them, Phoebe Stubblefield. She not only is really physically talented, but she is also very, very smart, right? And so when I teach her, I can get into a lot of details, right? And I can use scientific words and she gets it, right? Not every skater that's her age or younger can be taught in those terms. So when you're talking about applying knowledge, from sports science to working with young children, you just as a coach have to get a sense of whether they're there and they can accept complex words, right? That are maybe not in their vocabulary. And there are some skaters that actually need that kind of detail. They're that smart that you, right away at the young ages, you have to start talking to them about science and they get it and they need it. They need that understanding. And other skaters, that are young, you might have to talk in broad-based terms. You have to use a lot of analogies, right? So for example, on a jump takeoff, you can talk about the approach speed. You can talk about the loading zone. You can talk about the takeoff angle and direction and angular momentum changing to rotational momentum and horizontal momentum. You can use those terms to some kids and other kids. You have to say, look, you're like an airplane going down a runway. And when you get to the end of the runway, you got to take off. And airplanes go up into the air straight, right? And when they go up crooked or there's a little turbulence on the takeoff, the passengers start to scream, right? Or they get nervous. And so you've got to be like that pilot on that plane and take your body straight up into the air. So like, it's the same idea, but you have to teach sometimes in more creative or simple terms.
Yes, of
but
course.
But always there are underlying concepts, right?
So, talking about that, how do you use that knowledge in function of how the body works? I have heard that you explain to them about the muscles, about the bones.
Absolutely.
So how does that work? It's so interesting.
Yes. So depending on their age, I mean, sometimes it happens to coincide with what they're learning in school, right? Mm-hmm. So they're taking some basic anatomy and they're starting to learn about their thoracic spine or their trapezius muscles or their lats, right? If they start to know the names of muscles, then you can actually use those terms as you're working with them and trying to get their body to do something. Instead of saying, just get under the jump and lift, you can say, look, in the loading zone, when your pick goes in, you've got to go from your toe pick through the calf muscle, through your hamstrings, through your butt muscles to push your hips forward. Like you can talk like that and really start to help them understand how to use their posterior chain, which is so important in figure skating, right? That might be a broad-based concept that you introduce at a young age.
So have you noticed that using the concepts like that from a young age helps them to understand and land the jumps earlier?
Like I was saying earlier, it depends because you can start talking like that to some children and they could be totally bored with what you're saying. I mean, I guess the best way to say it is the lesson for me is not about showing them how smart I am.
Yeah.
The lesson for me is about helping them understand. And I think really good coaches don't just spit out a lot of good information. They look at what the skater's picking up on. They have a little bit of dialogue. They look at what they're seeing, and then the job is to get them to understand and learn as fast as possible.
They try to find a way to make them get the idea.
Yes, and an underlying principle of my coaching And I know many of my athletes will tell you this, even though it's based in maybe science, mm-hmm. I like to kiss, I call it kiss it, keep it simple. Because when you're doing a takeoff at a certain speed, and you've got to get your body to fire in, you know, 0.1 something seconds as soon as you leave the ice, if you're thinking too much, nothing really good is going to happen.
Oh, no.
Right? So even though they have to have an understanding of complex movement, they have to also put it together in their brain in a very simple way so they can move that quickly.
Yeah. Get it.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so your question is like, how do you get them to understand that?
Yeah. Well,
that's the joy of coaching, figuring it out every day, every lesson.
It's so beautiful.
And for me, it's really fun. I love doing it.
Yeah, it is. I'm a coach and I'm the type that talks about the airplane. I never get into the science part. And I just love to explain it in fun ways because also it takes off the pressure.
Yeah. So
they just get a little bit more relaxed. And it's so great to see when they get the idea and they understand what you're trying to teach them. And you see the improvement.
And I think the beauty of working with so many different, at least for me now in my career, because I've been coaching 30 years now, I've worked with so many different talented athletes, male and female, at all different levels. They've really taught me something too.
Oh, yeah.
So how each person learns is just something I put in my brain and also in a file on a piece of paper, mm-hmm. As to what works. And yeah. It's really good as a coach to have a broad language of skating, to mm-hmm. be able to talk about it in more than one way or two ways or three ways, to have 7, 8, 9, 10 ways of explaining something.
Yeah.
That just makes you better at your job, in my opinion. And it makes you more able to help all different types of skaters.
Yeah, I totally agree. Okay, tell me a little bit about the Seaboard you created. That's amazing.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, many, many years ago, I was coaching a skater named Jessica Fund, and her father is a carpenter. And we were working on her jumps off the ice, and she was having some issues with alignment of her knee over her toe, right? It's very common in skaters to not be able to hold that alignment at various stages through skating, right? Mm-hmm. But critically, when you land a jump and you're in a landing position and you go from the rotating position to the checkout, if yeah. there's any kind of wobbling in that area and the muscles aren't strong enough and the balance isn't really developed, you can really hurt yourself on a jump landing, yeah. right? And I don't mean just like sprain your ankle. You can cause damage to your knee. You can end up with hip pain, lower back pain. So in talking to her father, you know, I said this, you know, if you had something like this to help with balance beyond a BOSU, right? Because we all know that there are balance devices to help improve balance.
Yeah.
If you had something that was really like a skate, mm-hmm. It would probably be better. And so we chatted for a few minutes, and a few weeks later, he said, "Hey, I heard what you said. I created this board. What do you think about it?" I was like, "I think it's great." And he said, "Because it's your idea, I called it the Z board." So he had put a big Z on the board after my last name. And wow. ever since then, I've used that apparatus with my students in their off-ice work. And of course, if you look at my Instagram, you can see I have posts on how it's made. And that mm-hmm. is actually Jessica Fun's father making the Z-board. His name is Norm. And he hand makes everything. And it's made to mimic the stanchion mm-hmm. of a blade, of an average skate blade. And of course, it's a little wider on the bottom because it has to be, it's wood, right? But that height between the ground, mm-hmm. When you put your foot on it, and the actual relationship of the blade to the ice, to me is the most critical part.
Yeah, and I saw that you developed some of ice exercises from the Z board to jumps.
To so benches, to spinners, right. So basically, I've always been doing this. What happened was during the pandemic, when we were stuck at home, mm-hmm. and I started doing Zoom classes, I started basically showing the board in some of those classes as mm-hmm. a way to develop balance and as a way to develop core strength and stability. And then people kept saying, well, how do I get one? How do I get one? I never really thought of selling it before the pandemic. And with so many people doing dry land training, it seemed like the thing to do. A lot of those video posts on my Instagram account were being seen by like 40,000 people or more.
Wow.
And so, and some people were saying, hey, can I get one? And I just went to Norm and I said, look, can we make some of these, right? And that's how I ended up sharing this apparatus, because that original Z board, I believe, was made in 1998.
Oh,
so, really? Yeah, so I've been using that Z board for a while. I mean, a long time. But I've never really thought of, marketing it, so to speak, until just recently. And then, of course, because of the dry land training during the pandemic, I've come up with different ways to use it than I was using it, right? Because when you're stuck dry land training, your brain starts to go, huh, we need to keep working on this and we need to keep working on this, but we're not on the ice, but they can't jump, like they do on the ice. So what do? So I started creating new sets of exercises that I've been sharing on my Instagram posts.
That's amazing. I have to try it.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to get one for me and for my students and start.
Hey, I've already sold 3 or 4 to Mexico.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh my God, that's amazing.
Yeah.
I'll try. I promise. And I'll let you know how it goes.
What's your favorite color?
Pink.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, that is one of the, we have like normal pink and light pink. And those are two of the most popular colors. Go figure, right?
That's amazing. Okay. So when you have a skater and, how can I put it? When you have a skater, or even before a season starts, how do you start to plan the goals, all the goal planning? I know that's like a big deal and an important thing for you in your coaching. So how do you set the goals and plan the training to achieve the goals or objectives you have?
So I hate to plug another product, but I have a workbook that is an e-workbook on my website. It's called Go for the Goal.
Okay.
And it is a book that is written in English about how to come up with an idea first, and then take that idea from an idea and map it out into training. Oh, look at that. Mariah doing triple axels before she could do it. I love that.
I know. I just took this video from the guys from the learning, the skating lesson.
Yeah.
You guys, I'm using your video. And I think it's amazing because it shows how you're teaching the triple axel. I think this was in 2015.
Yep. I look so younger then, and look at Mariah.
No, I think it's amazing because now we can look back and remember that Mirai landed her triple axel in the Olympics. So that's amazing to watch this video. That's why I wanted to ask this question about the goals. Of course, this was a goal for you and Mirai. And
yes, and you know what? The one thing I will say about Mirai's triple axel was Mirai's goal. I mean, when she came to work with me, I don't think she necessarily thought that she would totally learn a triple axel, but she did tell me that she wanted to, right? Yeah. Oh, wow, look at that. Look at that. Oh. Yeah, it's kind of nice to look back on that. I guess I'm going to show you on my website here the workbook, because the only reason I'm showing you this is because when I did the cover for my goal setting book, I used Mirai's legs in the triple axle. So there is the name of my book.
Oh my God.
Go for the goal. And it's Mirai's feet on her triple axle from the Olympic Games.
That's amazing.
Because I do think that that achievement, we worked on it together for 4 years, right? So very few skaters. Well, first of all, what we know, at least from the Olympic research in the United States, is that a lot of athletes set goals.
Yeah.
So goal setting is very common, even in everyday life, people set goals, right? But goal achievement is different.
Of course.
And so that workbook is about taking that idea.
Creo que perdimos un poco la señal. Oh, Tom, are you there?
Well, you got to map that out ahead of time, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that doesn't just happen, you know, just because you come to the rink and you think of something each day.
Yeah.
Now, the other thing that's important when you set goals is to do it in pencil.
Okay.
And the reason I say that is because you can't be afraid of putting all your thoughts down.
Mm-hmm.
But once you start working, you have to make adjustments. So when you're like, when you're those, that workbook, you can print out the pages on a printer. Uh-huh. And I recommend that because the research shows that if you actually pick up a pencil and you write with your fingers, the connection from your brain through your hand when you write out your goals is way more powerful than thinking it or typing it. Like if I was on my computer and I was typing it out, it's not the same. So it's almost like the written goal is like a contract that you make with yourself.
Wow, that's amazing.
So just, I guess you're in terms of your question, you got to start with the idea and the pie in the sky dream that you have. And then you got to start picking up a pencil and writing down things that you can do. Now, the other thing I want to say is that sometimes when you goal set, you don't just have to write in words or sentences. Mm-hmm. There is a way to take your goal to look at it and be a little more creative with it. And I want to say that I have this hopefully in, oh, I don't have it in my, so basically when you go to my site, if you click on that, you can see excerpts from my book.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought I had a mind map there, but have you ever heard of mind mapping?
Yep.
Yeah, so you can take written words and you can be very creative with colors and diagrams and pictures and vision boards. Like you can take your goal and it doesn't just have to be sentences. It kind of comes alive when you get even more creative with it. Wow. And that process that you go through of taking that written goal and just kind of immersing yourself into it really gives you like the power to achieve it.
So after you have the idea, how do you like plan the training? Okay, let's say we are Mirai Nagatsu and she wants to land her triple axel. So she writes it down. And what comes next?
I mean, for me, okay, so I'm doing this with Brady right now, okay. Right? Because Brady wants to learn a triple axel. The mm-hmm. first thing you have to do is look at the overall technique. Because mm-hmm. if it isn't going to give you enough height, or if it isn't going to give you, like, so basically the technique of a triple axel is all through alignment.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes skaters do really big double axels, but they don't have the technique for a triple. Yeah. So they can jump pretty high. And if you're watching it, you could go, oh, wow, they could do a triple. But there are certain key things they have to do in their alignment.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes skaters get to a really high level and their coach hasn't known what to emphasize. Mm-hmm. And so they're doing a nice double axel, but they don't have the technique to do a triple. That's why you see so many skaters go on the fishing pole, mm-hmm. and they can do beautiful triple axels. And then you take them off the fishing pole and they cannot do it by themselves. That's because the fishing pole compensates for certain key parts of your body, mainly in your shoulders and your hips. And you have to learn to do those things with the rocking on your toe pick for the takeoff. Otherwise, you're never going to get that jump clean. So because I've had many years of experience, I can take a skater right away and go, okay, you need to work on this and you need to work on this. And if you don't do these two things, you will never get it clean. So I don't really guess anymore. When I first started coaching triple axels, I'll admit it, I was guessing a little. I think we got to do this, or I think we got to do this. And I think to a certain extent, all coaches do that, right? But then the more you've done something and taught something, the less guessing you do. Mm-hmm. So then when a skater like Brady comes to me, I can go right away. Mm-hmm. You got to do this and you got to do this. And you have to do this first. And then you do this second. And then you do this third. Right. So I know the order that has to be built in order to get a jump clean. So when you're asking how you take that goal, well, what my skaters do is they bring their goals to me. And then fortunately, I can mostly say, okay, this is what you have to do now.
So you break it down and you start from there.
Mm-hmm.
And okay.
And there's a great diagram, since you just said that, break it down, there's a great diagram on that page that I'll just highlight now, because these are the building blocks. So you have the daily goal, the weekly goal, the monthly goal, the yearly goal, and then you have the Olympic goal, wow. That 4 years. And what most people do is they go, I want to go to the Olympics. Right? Yeah, but then they don't. But they don't backtrack in the right order. Mm-hmm. So part of the trick to goal setting is starting with your idea and then your end point, mm-hmm. and deciding how much time you have, and what do you have to do first, and what will you have to do at the end, and then you kind of converge those thoughts. Mm-hmm. And if it doesn't work out, for example, if you have 4 years to the Olympics.
Yeah.
You write down what you're going to need to do at the Olympic Games. So that involves some imagination.
Yeah, of course.
I mean, who knew that Mirai Nagasu would need to do a triple axel to be on the Olympic team? She wanted to, but no one knew that that would be her ticket, right? And then look at what's happened since then, right? All over the world and with the Russian girls. I mean, even the Russian girls in Pyeongchang were not doing quadruples.
Oh, no, just triple, and that was it.
Yeah, and so when you set goals like that, you've got to be able to be a visionary. You've got to look at trends in the sport. You've got to make some educated guesses. And then you got to see where you are right now. And then you have to work back. And that's why I said you got to do it with a pencil. Because you've got to make sure all 4 years and what you're going to do each year makes sense.
Yeah, definitely. I wanted to talk about this topic because, for example, in Mexico, we are just starting to have great skaters. But before, we didn't know much about figure skating in general. So, I don't know, it's so amazing to start... learning about these things, about goal setting and how to achieve the goals and breaking down the goal and, all that kind of stuff. So it's very interesting. I think so many people could learn from this.
Yes, and goal setting is twofold. So number one, when your skater sets a goal, that gives them purpose.
Yeah.
They're engaged, right? And as long as it's realistic, they will keep coming to the rink and trying.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. And when they set for example, the very common goal that all skaters want to do is learn a double axel cleanly. That's a big milestone. So when a skater says, I want to get my double axel, it gives them purpose. And then when the coach says, okay, for the first week that you're going to work on the double axel, we got to make sure your technique is right.
Mm-hmm.
And you work on that for a whole week or maybe 2 weeks, right? And then the second week, the coach says, okay, now we got to make sure you're jumping high enough, right? So there's a minimum airtime that you need for a clean double axel, and that's 10 inches. If you're not jumping 10 inches, you won't get a clean double axel, no matter how tight you pull it, right? Now, if you jump more than 10 inches, you could get it clean. Your rotating position could be more open, but on average, everybody who does a clean double axel jumps 10 inches.
Mm-hmm.
So why did I say for the first couple of weeks you would work on technique? Well, because a jump that swings around at all doesn't jump high.
Mm-hmm.
So if the coach isn't fixing the alignment in those first few weeks of working on a double axel and the position of the head and the axle's swinging into the circle, but maybe it's 10 inches, but it's swinging into the circle. Well, they're not going to get it clean.
Yeah.
That's how the coach then says, okay, your goal is the double axel. Now my goal for you these first couple of weeks is to fix this.
Mm-hmm.
And so it also gives the coach direction for the lesson. Then everybody's really clear. When your student comes to you, Masha, you're not wondering what you should teach them. They told you, I want to learn the double axel. Mm-hmm. And then they're not wondering how to do it. You're telling them, I want you to do this first. And now we're going to check your jump height. And this next, after your jump height is 10 inches on average, meaning you don't just jump 10 inches one time, but you know how to jump 10 inches many times, right? So you know that feeling of hitting the top of the jump. Now we're going to work on how you collect your arms and your feet really quickly, right? And tightly, right? So if you give them an order, your coaching becomes more efficient and purposeful, and then their learning does too.
Wow, you are so wise. I mean, that's amazing. I think this will work for everybody. And you should sell your book everywhere. I mean, I don't know if
it's on my website, so people can go and download it. So once you buy it, you just click on a button and it downloads right into your tablet or phone or computer, amazing, however you want to do it.
I will.
Yeah.
Okay. Talking about the nationals, what are your expectations for your athletes, your skaters, for these nationals if they're happening?
So we just found out today they are. Our national.
Las Vegas, right?
Yes, it just got announced a few hours ago. So we are so, so excited that we will have an in-person competition. And I think it's fair to say that U.S. figure skating used Skate America as a template to work out what does the bubble look like for figure skating. And how do we do this and keep everybody safe? And I think now that that was so successful, they thought, wow, we could do the same thing for the US championships. And, you know, my expectations, you're showing pictures of the kiss and cry. Yeah. I always like to work really hard ahead of time so that you're sitting there really happy.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You want to hug your athlete. They want to hug you. You've got smiles on your faces. So my expectation is that you have those moments where you feel that reward, right? And also you can share it with the people that help the athlete, right? Besides you. You know, this day and age, there's a primary coach, but there's a whole heck of a lot of support that goes on.
That's amazing.
To help an athlete reach their goals and their podium, right? Now, this year, it's going to look different because of COVID. Only one coach can actually be there. And as you can see at Skate America, no coaches will sit in the kiss and cry.
I noticed. Creo que nuestro invitado tuvo problemas de internet. Tom, are you there?
Health turned out okay. I competed the way I wanted to and delivered the performances that I wanted to. I did the best that I could this year. Like, that's really what it's all about.
Yeah, I mean, this problem has been like everywhere. So nobody can blame the skaters, the coaches. They're doing what you can.
Yeah.
And of course, all the skaters had to stop skating for a few months and then come back. Actually, I was talking with Vincent, and he told me all his story about Brown and then skating back again after, I don't know, some 4 or 5 months without skating. And then as soon as he came back skating, the pandemic happened, so he had to stop again. And he told me he was getting his quads back again. And then I saw him in the competition, and I was so happy because he did an amazing job.
Yeah. Yeah. And so that's the other thing. I mean, in general, when you figure skate, you learn to be resilient.
Yeah.
Because you fall down from the get-go, right? I don't know any figure skater that hasn't fallen down. Yeah. So right away, and when you fall down, it hurts. The ice is hard. Even if you're little, even if you're tiny, it still hurts. So skaters, I think, have this mindset of always getting up, always overcoming, right? Yeah. And, you know, everybody has stories of feeling like they were judged unfairly. Anytime mm-hmm. you're in a judge sport, you feel like, wow, the politics wasn't on my side or my skater's side, or, you know, like, why didn't they score me better? But yet you keep doing it, right? And you keep doing it because you love it. And so I think the pandemic is just one more distraction like that. But I think so many figure skaters already have the mindset of overcoming, right? Whether it's falling or whether it's politics or whether it's, you know, you lost a title or didn't pass a test, or you just get back into it and you keep on finding a way, right? And I remember that expression when Doug Lee came to work in Colorado Springs many years ago. I think it was 2004 or 5 when he came to do a seminar. And the big words that he used during that seminar, I'll never forget them, was find a way.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what went wrong. It doesn't matter, like to the coaches, he would say, it doesn't matter what the skater did wrong. And to the skaters, he would say, it doesn't matter what you did wrong. Mm-hmm. Everyone's job is to find a way. And yeah. that is our job during this pandemic, find a way. And look around the world, everybody's finding a way, right?
Of course. Even when we couldn't skate, we found a way to kind of skate at home, doing exercises, you with your Z-board or the competitions with the spinners.
Or dry land competition or virtual competitions. Like it's kind of human nature. Sometimes I tell this to my teenage skaters when they get all discouraged as their body's growing and they know how to do something, but yet all of a sudden they can't do it as easily or they're doing it less consistently. I always say, you know, if they have a bad attitude, I always say, show me a baby that falls down and cries and just sits there. There's no such thing. When babies are learning to walk, they go from sitting up to crawling to standing up and holding on to walking, and they start falling down and they get right back up, right? And then they start running and they fall down and they get right back up. Like, that's human nature. So nothing will stay the same. The pandemic won't stay the same. It won't last. Yeah. There will be an end point. Mm-hmm. And during this time when it seems like it's so difficult, nobody's stopping. Right? Just because there's no ice, or just because there's less ice, or like everybody's still going because human nature says we keep going, right?
Yeah, that's amazing. And about Worlds, of course, you had some expectations for the World Championships and it didn't happen. So for next year's World Championships, are your expectations the same for your skaters, or did they change?
For me, they're the same. And the reason they're the same is because two things. We don't really know what's going to happen with the pandemic still.
Yeah.
It's starting to spike again, right? And so that's one thing. And that's what stopped the World Championships last year, was mm-hmm. the pandemic, right? And then number two is we have no idea what the ISU is going to do. So obviously Cup of China just happened, right? Skate America happened, but Skate Canada did not, and either did Trophy Bompard, right? Or the French competition in France. So when you have those situations where some places it's working and some places it's not, it's hard to say what the ISU will do. Could they create a bubble for international coaches and competitors and officials? Probably. How much money would that take? How much time would that take? Right? So I think that from my point of view, with my athletes, especially like Brady and Vincent, who would be likely to go to a world championships, provided that they skated well. Mm-hmm. My conversations with them are simply, you've got to keep going right now, and you've got to do the best you can. And then we've got to wait, and you've got to be flexible and prepared that the same thing that happened to them last year could also happen this year.
Yeah.
And, you know, who knows? And both of those athletes, I mean, they're Olympians, right? Brady's a national senior champion. Vincent is a national champion at other levels, and mm-hmm. he's working to be a national senior champion. So they both have a great amount of maturity, and they understand, right, that as much as they can do right now, there is that chance that there might not be a world. For me, that's not something for us to focus on. But you do have to talk about it, because you kind of have to know your end game, right? Yes. And for those two, world championships is the end of their season, right? They would want to qualify for that event. So we have to have some discussion on it, but we're not focused on it. And quite frankly, that's beyond our control.
Yeah.
So to a certain extent, whether it's the pandemic or the ISU, we just have to wait and see.
And be patient. But
in the meantime, we're just going to keep on going.
Okay, so talking about the Olympics. Okay, assuming we will have Olympics in 2022, you know, about the ladies and men.
Today, I will tell you, today that seems more likely because of the vaccine. So the news of how successful the vaccine was, by the time it might be time for the 2022 games, probably most of the world might be able to be vaccinated.
Or the people. I think so too. So, okay, let's assume that it will happen. What is your opinion that, what will happen, in your opinion, with the ladies and men competition? I mean, of course, with
the men?
Yeah, ladies and men. Okay, so we are kind of watching the competitions today, and we kind of see the pieces of the puzzle coming together. We could maybe think which ladies could win the Olympics or which guys. So in your opinion, how do you think the podium could be?
Wow, I mean, it's so interesting. Like based on last season leading up to the World Championships, mm-hmm. you would have said, boy, it will be a Russian sweep, right? Those three ladies. Kostyumaya, Cherbakova, and Trusova. Like, they were destined for that podium. And then there was no world championship. So, you know, when I got that question from you, I started thinking about it. Part of what skaters do with the world championships, especially if you have zero experience, none. Mm-hmm. And those three girls have no experience at a world. They haven't gone to one yet.
Yeah.
Their first worlds was canceled.
Mm-hmm.
So you use the world championships to gain experience so that when you get to an Olympic Games, you're ready for it. So now it could be that some of those athletes actually end up at the Olympic Games with zero experience at that level.
Yeah, it could happen.
And the Olympic Games is not like the world championships. You know, even though you might have the same competitors from the world championships, the Olympic Games is so much bigger than that because it's like 100 sports that have their world of championships at one time, right? Not 100, but a lot. So it has such a bigger than life feeling. So then thinking of that, you go, well, who's going to hold up under that pressure?
Of course.
It might be their first time at a major event like that.
And they're young also.
And they're young. And sometimes your first Olympic Games isn't so good. Or sometimes it's really good. Like Zagitova, right? Yeah. She went from junior world champion to Olympic champion in how many months? Mm-hmm. Right? Less than a year. Because sometimes you're so young, it doesn't even occur to you.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's, boy, I'll tell you, I'm not a predictor. I think that everything that everybody was thinking may not happen, especially in the ladies. Now, if you look at skaters like Nathan Chen, Liu Hanyu, Vincent Zhou, who's a world medalist, Bo Yang Jin, who's a world medalist, if you look at that mix of guys headed into an Olympic Games, you could say that they all have the experience. They all know what it takes, not only to get to an Olympics, but certainly Hanyu knows how to win an Olympics, defend an Olympic title. So that's like so different on the men's side. But I think on the ladies' side, it's more of an unknown.
So besides the Russian girls, who do you think could, you know, fight that fight?
Oh boy, I mean, certainly, I think after her performance at Four Continents, you would have to say Young Yu from Korea. And having worked with her for a whole season, I can tell you that she's very driven and very competitive. And then look, Brady Tennell ended up on the Four Continents podium.
Yeah.
And I mean, she was the first woman since Mirai to reach that podium for the United States. And the European podium was, in fact, the three Russian girls, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So, I mean, the kind of Rika Kihira, we knew she won Four Continents. We knew she was a force, but yet she didn't get the world medal in her own country at the World Championships. So that's the other part of it. You can be really good. You can win a Grand Prix final. You can win a Four Continents. But when you get to the World Championships or the Olympic Games, it's not so easy. Like, just because you're really good doesn't mean you're ready for that. So, I mean, obviously she is in the mix too. So, boy, you just never know. Who would have thought that, you know, Caitlin Osman was going to get an Olympic bronze medal and win the world championships the next I mean, like, that's the cool thing about figure skating. It's slippery. Yeah. And so even if there's sometimes if there's just that little bit of opportunity, look what can happen.
I know. I think it's one of those competitions that in the moment, what happens in the moment. And it's going to be crazy with the Russian girls and Brady and Japan. Oh, my God. It's going to be amazing. And the guys, we're going to be dying watching that.
I mean, look, you see how well the Russian guy now is doing that. He's with Mishin, right? His technique has totally changed. He's so much more consistent, you can tell. So, I mean, he does a quad lutz. You know, they're like, you just never know. I think in the men's event, it's going to be hard for a young boy to come up.
Yeah.
I mean, there may be some really good young Japanese boys. We have a young American boy here doing a quad lutz now. But in the next year and a half, are they going to be seasoned enough, strong enough? No.
No. These guys you mentioned, Yusu, Nathan, Vincent, who else?
Bo Yang.
Yeah. These guys are amazing and so consistent. And now that Yusu and Nathan and are trying quad axel, you never know.
I have to tell you, being at Skate America, that was a little bit thrilling for me to watch Nathan Chen practice quad axel. And I really think that his attempts were much, much better than Hanyu's. If,
I think so
if
too.
You look at what he was actually doing, and of course I got to sit there and I took some video from up above where we were allowed to watch practice, and I'm looking at the technique and studying the technique. Nathan really has, I think, a better sense of axis right at the start of the jump.
Yeah.
And Hanyu's may rotate a tiny bit more, but when you watch the attempts that we've seen, at least on, you know, YouTube or social media, Hanyu's axis goes like this as he rotates, but Nathan's axis stays straight. And if you're going to land a jump, any skater out there and any coaches out there, this is very obvious, but remember, if you don't leave the ice straight and your axis isn't somewhat straight, and I don't mean perpendicular, but I mean straight, if you are leaning, most likely you're going to fall. So when I see Nathan's axle that straight, I think, wow, he could probably do it.
I know. And have you seen the attempt from Artur Dmitriev?
I have, yes.
What do you think?
I mean, I thought that was amazing. That was not on a fishing pole. There were a lot of attempts at that time circulating, but his was not on a fishing pole. So I definitely think, I've said this for many years, as soon as this barrier is broken, the ISU is going to have to come up with a new scale that says 5S, 5T, because it'll be Quint Saukau and Quint Tolup next.
Oh my God. It's crazy. I
mean, yeah. And I think with all the advances in coaching in terms of tools that you can use as a coach, and I don't mean like the fishing pole harness. I mean, all the technology that you can use on an iPad or an iPhone, right? That helps you bring science to your skaters. So you can get instant feedback on their airtime. So you can start to analyze things that you used to have to wait weeks for. When I first started coaching, a high-speed video analysis would take weeks and weeks. Now you have something really close instantly. And then young skaters are armed with that, right? And then they go on social media and they see all these, the other skaters around the world learning, and they're posting things and they're going, oh, if she can do that, I can do that, right? So the whole mindset of learning is so different. So you've got that technology, plus the equipment is finally improving.
Yeah.
The boot design and the blade design. And so now you start, if you're really smart, and this is a message to all the coaches, start looking at your athletes' bodies. Like I was saying, the relationship of the size of their head to their feet. Start to look at their feet. Start to educate yourself on the toe box and the heel of each boot and what is best for your athlete. Then look at how they move instinctively and decide what kind of rocker you want for them to be on. And start and decide if you want a lightweight blade or you don't. Start to make some decisions like that, because that also allows the sport to advance, right? It's that improvement in the actual equipment and padding. So now they can fall and it doesn't hurt so much. Like, there's so much going on that allows the skater to really progress.
Yeah, absolutely. And okay, last question, and I leave you to rest. Okay, so talking about the ladies, you know, there it's crazy talking now with the quads. So many people are really impressed, because watching young girls doing quads, it's really impressive. But on the other hand, they get injured and their careers, you know, end really soon when they're young. So what's your opinion on that?
I mean, I think that's kind of, you summed it up. It's a trade-off. And I kind of look at it like, I mean, we had that with Tara Lipinski and Sarah Hughes. So Michelle Kwan had a long, long career, right? She was young at her first Olympics, but she also had a long career, almost to a third Olympics if she wasn't injured. So, Tara Lipinski and Sarah Hughes just went to one Olympics and they got their gold medal at the right time.
They retired, yeah.
Yeah. And they both were doing triple triples. Tara mm-hmm. was doing it ahead of her time. When you think about it, and she did the triple toe Euler triple sal way back in 1990.
Yeah, I know.
That's incredible. Like, that was amazing. So ahead of her time. And a triple loop, when everybody else was maybe doing a triple toe combo. So she was ahead of her time. That's mm-hmm. almost like the quadruples now, right? And then, of course, Sarah, you know, doing two triple triples at the Olympics when she needed mm-hmm. to. Like, so when I look at the Russian girls, like Zagitova, it's hard to say, because some of those younger Russian girls didn't win, right, in Sochi. Yulia Lipnitskaya, she was kind of the favorite, but she didn't actually get, she got the team gold medal, but she didn't get
the singles.
The singles. So, Zagitova won young and then retired, but wow, what a nice moment for her, right? Yeah. So she wasn't doing quadruples.
No, but in her time, it was a big deal to do triple triples and all her jumps in the first half of the program. So it was huge.
The last half of the program, yeah, back end loading. Yeah, so like right now, these young girls doing quadruples, it's so interesting. A lot of people criticize Trusova, but if you actually look at her technique, it is more pure to ballet alignment than she's given credit for.
I know.
So sometimes you can look at, I won't name the other Russian girls because they're regarded as more beautiful.
I know.
But when you break down their technique and how they jump and spin in slow motion, they have what I call broken angles.
Yeah.
And
I get what you mean.
In slow motion, it doesn't look so good.
Yeah.
So for me, I look at that and I go, wow, like the way Trusova holds her arms and the way she can extend her pick and point her toe.
Yeah.
Like the other two girls can't do that.
No, actually I was watching.
They bend their legs at right angles.
Yeah,
They hammer pick. And their arms are tilted and funnier looking.
Yeah.
So I've always looked at the criticism of Trusova and went, why? Like, I see the beauty in it.
Yeah, me too. I love her jumps because she's also kind of like really strong, like as a guy. I was watching last week her video of the quad toe beside side by side Yusuru Hanyu. Oh my God, the height is the same because they stay in the air like the same time.
Yeah.
It was so huge. And
so for me, I think of all of those positions as skating skills.
Yeah.
I don't think of just skating around the ice as skating skills. Of course, that's a big part of skating skills, but actually how you hold your arms and your free leg in when you take, like right before the takeoff, that's posture too, right? And I think Trusova has that, of all the Russian girls, she has that posture that I think is much better. So it's weird when you talk about, well, she's doing quadruples, but I think she also does them beautifully. Like they're beautiful. They're not like, they're attractive, not just because she jumps as high as Hanyu, but because the way she looks doing them is quite nice.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
And it, like I said, it's grounded in ballet. And, you know, I do think her technique has improved. So the interesting thing for me is of all of the Russian ladies that have come out of the pandemic, she's come out the best, I think.
Yeah, I think so too.
And I think she looks better than ever. And I think the triple axel's better. I think the quad toe loop is not even the same as what it used to be.
No, it's bigger and
the technique has really changed.
Yes.
And that's not easy to do. It's not easy to take a technique on a quadruple and manipulate it because your body gets used to a certain muscle memory, but she has. So, you know, you're talking about should ladies do quads? And I mean, to me, I go back to Patrick Chan, because I was having Ryan Bradley and I was trying to get Jeremy Abbott to do not just one quad, but two quads, because he had a beautiful quad saukow. He never did it in competition in a program, but he used to do it on practices. And then, you know, Brandon Rose, I was trying to get all those guys to do multiple quads way back when. And then Patrick Chan came along and he did two quads and looked beautiful. So the way I like to think about it is, it's not really, is it quads or just elegant lady skating? I think, well, who could really do it all? Could some lady do it all?
I think Trusova can. I mean, yeah. She has a little bit of time ahead, so she can keep working. And
I think Kostornaya was that complete package last season. I don't know if she still has the axel. It's kind of hard to say. But last season when she did that beautiful triple axel, she was kind of the package, wasn't she? Like she was doing
today actually in the first stage of Cup of Russia, and she's not trying the triple axel, but everything else is it's amazing. I mean, I love her choreography, her skating skills in general, her spins, and I love her huge jumps. So if she has the triple axel, oh my God.
Right, so that's what I'm saying when you were talking about, like, what do you think about the young girls that are so technical versus, you know, ladies skating? Well, I think for me, if I could see someone do it all, that would be the best. I mean, that's what I'm trying to help. That's why I'm trying to help Brady get the triple axel clean, so that she can actually be one of those ladies that also has some of that content, right? Because to me, it's not like you look at what you're good at and you go, okay, I'm gonna try to win only this way.
Yeah.
Well, there are a whole bunch of skaters that have been on the world podium or close to winning that try to stay the same, and they don't stay on the podium ever again.
Right?
So I think the key is to always better yourself in every way.
Yeah.
So those quadruple jumpers, the Russian girls that are doing quadruples, they should spin fast. They should interpret their music. They should skate great. And the girls that do that, but no quadruples, they should learn the quadruples, right? Like if everybody's going for everything, that's what makes, you know, on the men's side, that makes the sport so exciting now, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Even from a few years ago, because you can see Bo Yang and Vincent, those two in particular, they're really starting to develop style now.
I know.
And first choreography.
Jumps, and now the choreography.
Right. So then you can watch five or six men and go, wow, they're all quadruple jumpers. They do multiple quads and they're all good spinners. And boy, their programs are also interesting. To me, that's what makes everybody tune in.
Yes.
It kind of gets ho-hum. You kind of go ho-hum when you know what the result is going to be. But when you don't know, because like I said, it's slippery and someone might fall, you turn on your television or you go to, you know, the live stream and you're like, okay, who's going to do it?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So ultimately, the answer to your question is just do more.
Yeah, always
do. No matter what type of skater you are, follow the Olympic motto, faster, higher, stronger, right? Like be more. Yeah, try to do as much as possible. But like, I think your point was about you retire early because it takes a toll on its body. But that's what I was saying. Hopefully with the biomechanical information that's available, the apps that can analyze, and then also the improvement in padding and equipments and pole harnesses, hopefully the risk of injury and what it does to the body can lessen a bit.
Yeah, I know. Personally, I think it's worth it. If you retire after winning an Olympics doing quads, for me, it would be worth it.
I have several friends, good friends that are dancers. And so their bodies, dancers, right? They're not even going into the air and coming down to the impact of the floor like figure skaters do on the ice. And their bodies are beat up too. Their toes, their feet, their hips, their knees. Because anytime you do something so passionately, so completely, for so many years, something's going to happen to your body, right? So I don't think it's just figure skating or sport in general. I think you can look and just see that, you know, nothing in that kind of excess is good, right? We know that. But yet you can't stop someone's will to do something.
Oh, yeah, of course.
And I really feel like these skaters that you're talking about in the ladies division or the men, they have such a strong will to win.
Yeah.
Not just to reach the podium, they have the will to win, that they will do everything. Yeah, they'll do everything it takes, which is really cool. I think that's great for the sport.
Yeah, I think so too. Well, this was all for today, but hopefully we can have another interview soon when Brady and Vincent win titles, many titles.
Yeah, I mean, fingers crossed. Yeah, yeah. That's the fun for all the coaches watching and all the skaters watching. We all show up at the rink and we all do the work every day because we want those moments in the future. You know, it's very cliche to say when you're standing atop the podium, it's all worth it. But in fact, it's true, right? And we all love figure skating. And Masha, I want to thank you for inviting me to this interview. It was so fun to speak with you. Your questions were amazing. And my fans and friends in Mexico, hola.
Thank you. Thank you so much. This was very, how can I say it? I learned so many things now, not only for the interview, but as a coach. So this has been amazing. Thank you so much. I think the audience will love, some people were watching now, but the interview will stay as a video in my channel. So I think everybody who watches this interview will be thrilled and they will learn so much. And thank you very much for being here.
Gracias.
And thank you everybody for watching. Gracias a todos. And I will definitely see you soon in another interview.
For sure. Buenas noches. Adios.